The status quo is not working. Science, mindfulness, and materialism is a dialogue between Shastri Holly Gayley and Dr. B. Alan Wallace. Holly Gayley is an assistant professor in Buddhist studies at the University of Colorado Boulder and is a senior teacher in the Shambhala community. With a master's in Buddhist studies from Naropa University and a PhD in Tibetan and Himalayan studies from Harvard, Holly travels to Tibetan areas regularly for her research on contemporary Buddhist movements. B. Alan Wallace, PhD, is a dynamic lecturer, progressive scholar, and one of the most prolific writers and translators of Tibetan Buddhism in the West. He continually seeks innovative ways to integrate Buddhist contemplative practices with Western science to advance the study of the mind.
So welcome to Awaken the World. I'm delighted to be here today with Dr. Alan Wallace, who is speaking to us from Australia, I believe. Welcome, Alan.
Thank you. I'm delighted to join you.
So you are a leader in what's called now the mind science conversation, having participated with many of the conferences organized by Mind Life with His Holiness, the Dalai Lama. And I'm curious if you could tell us, first of all, how you got interested in consciousness studies, but also how did the mind science dialogue get started altogether?
Oh, it started in the mind science dialogue has started in different ways within Buddhism. It might have started about 1973 when His Holiness the Dalai Lama first came to Europe and he met with some world-class physicists, and it started there. But of course, it's not simply one person, although the Dalai Lama has been very, very prominent in this and I think a wonderfully creative and intelligent way. To briefly make this very personal, when I was growing up, I was raised in a very Christian household. My father's a theologian, but from the age of 13, I wanted to pursue a career in science. And I did that, very focused. I wanted to become an ecologist from the age of 13. By the time I was 20, though, I just found that I didn't have a home in the Christian doctrine. It just didn't resonate with me. It didn't make sense, and I couldn't believe a number of its core tenets. So that wasn't an option. You can't believe what you can't believe. But by the time I was 20 and had been studying science and was really getting ready to launch a career in science, I found that it just wasn't providing me with a sense of meaning. And I found that was a strong urge in me from early on to lead a meaningful life and simply to have a lot of facts and knowledge about the world and be doing some good in the world. It just wasn't enough. I wanted something more inner, and ecology, frankly, all the sciences don't really give you much nourishment within to find greater fulfillment and meaning and self-knowledge. Not in my experience, that I can say as a fact, did not. And so feeling a real dissatisfaction, and that led to my abandoning Western civilization for about 13 years, going to India, becoming a monk, and immersing myself in Tibetan culture, and specifically in Tibetan Buddhism, and also Theravada and so forth. But then after about 14 years of that, from the age of 20 until I was 34, pretty much just turning my back on Western civilization, all of it, and just immersing myself in a worldview where I did feel at home. And it was very sharp and smart and critical and rational and empirical, but it was also meaningful and transformative and fulfilling. I found what I wanted. But what I had done in the process was I basically cut myself off from the first 20 years of my life. I would often say when I was in my 20s, I was born when I was 20, because that's when things started to make sense. You know, but of course you can't do that. You can't simply, you know, divorce decades of your life. And so I decided, after I'd been in a series of meditation retreats for about 4 years, after 10 years of very intensive training in Buddhism, I came back and said, I think now it's time to integrate with Western civilization. And I thought, well, one of the big things I've left behind was science. And it's not just a lot of hooey. It's not just anything. There's a lot of facts, a lot of knowledge it's very valuable. And so I decided, well, I'd like to see how this Buddhist worldview, how does it interface with the modern scientific worldview? And I decided, why don't we go for the discipline within science that many people consider to be bedrock, and historically it is, and that is the physical sciences, physics. And so I was fortunate enough to be admitted to Amherst College, which is an outstanding liberal arts college, and spent 2.5 years, golden years, really, studying physics right from the ground, Newtonian, electromagnetism, quantum mechanics, relativity, studied calculus, studied a lot of philosophy and history of science, And so that's where it started for me. I just wanted to bring these parts of my life and my education into full dialogue. And so that's where it started for me in 1984. And then to wrap this up quickly, then I went into retreat again when I graduated there. And then I organized a one-year meditation retreat. So for 2 years, basically, it was retreat. And then I decided maybe it would be good to go back to academia and, again, wrap up some loose ends. Like, I was raised in a Christian family. I have been deeply exposed to Western religion, but also to philosophy. And so I went to Stanford, spent 6 years there in religious studies, and I did comparative contemplative studies, what a lot of people would call comparative mysticism. And that was to, again, bring these strands of my life so it was one coherent whole and not just a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And it was during that time, 1989. So when I was just about to matriculate at Stanford, that's when I was invited to serve as an interpreter, one of two interpreters, together with Thupten Jinpa, the Dalai Lama's primary interpreter, for this series of conferences of the Mind and Life Institute. And I was very deeply involved in that from 1989, very, very active. And I'm still, I think, a senior fellow or something. I'm still affiliated with it, but I just have a lot of things to do outside of my life, so I'm not so actively engaged. But they're doing a lot of good work. And my own writing, my teaching, speaking at conferences, lecturing at universities all over the world, does tend to focus a lot on this dynamic. On the one hand, Buddhism and the physical sciences, where I've had some fairly robust training, but I've participated in a lot of collaborative research with people like Richard Davidson, Cliff Seren, Margaret Kemeny, a psychologist and neuroscientist, to really try to scientifically understand what are the benefits, but also the limitations of meditation. So I've been doing that since 1990. So a lot of engagement. And it's driven by, and I'll end on this note, it's driven by a very core conviction. And that is that if the Buddha Dharma, which I deeply cherish, if this is going to manifest its full potential, if it's going to be as relevant, as meaningful, as beneficial as it possibly can in the 21st century, then it has to be in full dialogue with the other religious traditions of the world, with modern philosophy and even ancient philosophy, but above all, I think, with science, because science is the dominant knowledge paradigm, both methodologically as well as what is its view. And to ignore that, for Buddhists living in the modern world, to ignore science is really back to the ostrich burying its head in the sand kind of syndrome. Hello, there's some competition out there. Maybe it's competition, maybe they're collaborators, but there is another show in town and it's a very loud show and it's called science. And if we ignore that, we make ourselves irrelevant. We don't make science irrelevant. And we run the danger of making Buddhism irrelevant, because it will just look like one more naive belief system, which is how many atheists and skeptics and so forth like to just kind of backhand religion altogether. Oh, shucks, what do they know? They're confused. They're believers, whereas we scientists, you know, we stick with the facts. Well, that's a lovely myth. It doesn't happen. It has very little truth in it, but it's a very common myth that's dominating the media nowadays.
Thank you. Just as a follow-up to that, reading through some of the transcripts from the dialogues with the Dalai Lama and scientists organized by the Mind and Life Institute, I'm struck by sometimes how polite the conversation is, and yet I wonder where the real meeting points are. For example, when the Dalai Lama says that consciousness is not irreducible to matter, that mm-hmm. feels like a kind of foundational difference. And I just ask you, where does the rubber meet the road in that case?
I want to be very diplomatic here. I'm not involved in Mind and Life now for years, for about 7 years. I spoke at a conference last year, and I was critiquing exactly this point. And that it says, you know, in science, they say, what is credible evidence? What is credible evidence? And I gave a talk on that in Massachusetts about a year ago at a big Mind and Life meeting. Many hundreds of people were there. And I said, you know, what is credible evidence for one group, maybe utterly incredible evidence for another, you know? So what you just said, is consciousness anything other than matter? From the Buddhist perspective, we'd say, why on earth are you asking that question? Why do you think that chemicals give rise to dreams? I mean, really, this is outlandish. You know, I've studied physics. And when you study physics, you never learn about a particular type of physics, a sub-branch of physics. And these are the chemicals and the matter and energy that actually give rise to subjective experience. It's not there at all, period. And so to say that somehow consciousness is arising from matter is actually a belief without any supportive evidence. What we do know, and many neuroscientists know this, but it's not often mentioned in public, is we know there are very strong correlations between brain activity and subjective experience. But what's the nature of those brain, what's the nature of those correlations? Is it true that all possible states of consciousness arise independent upon brain activity? Well, you could say that as a factual statement if you knew what is the range of all possible states of consciousness. But that's pretty bombastic. Why in the world do you think you know the whole range? Have you hung out in the Himalayas recently? You know, have you hung out with yogis who spent 30, 40 years in retreat? Do you really think you've fathomed what they've experienced over 40 years? There's a lot of hubris in this. And I think, frankly, it's massive ethnocentricity. So in these dialogues, I've seen it happen multiple times, where the Dalai Lama is a highly empirical and rational person. He really is very, very much so. He will cite a case of empirical evidence. He cited, I remember very vividly, I think it was a little girl, or maybe it was twins, who had very clear past life recall. And then it was corroborated. And it seemed like there was no way they could possibly know about this information from their past lives, apart from they actually were remembering it. And the Dalai Lama, you know, pointed this out and said, you know, this seems like empirical evidence. Maybe there is continuity. And the scientists, I want to be very polite here, but I remember one of them said, well, let's move on from metaphysical issues and get back to the empirical. Well, I'm sorry, but that was empirical. And what you want to move back to is a metaphysical context where you feel comfortable. And where you feel comfortable is the mind is simply a product of the brain or it's equivalent to brain function. So my personality tends to be blunt. I'm not particularly good at diplomacy. I'm too old for it. I don't have a position to protect. I'm not trying to get tenure. I don't have tenure. I really just say what I think. And if people don't like it, they can just stop listening, you know. But I feel we really need to be much more candid and recognize that we in the West, for 150 years easily, we could say 400 years, we've been trying to understand the mind by doing everything other than except looking at the mind, because that's subjective, right? That's not scientific. Well, I'm sorry, but for all other branches of science, if you know, for starting from Galileo, the way scientifically you really understand something is by looking at it with as much sophistication and rigor and precision as you possibly can. You don't just look at correlates. If you understand the moon, you don't look at tides. If you understand if you want to understand the sun, you don't look at your sunburn. You look at the sun, right? And so, in terms of traditional science for the last 400 years, if we follow the lead of all other branches of science, which is in focus almost entirely on studying brain correlates, behavior, and interviewing people about their subjective experience, that's all very well, but they're all missing the target. They're all doing something that is out of tune, out of touch, out of alignment with the kind of science that's worked very well for 400 years. And I think it's because of this precisely that over the last 135 years, 140 years since the rise of modern science, 1875 is kind of a time with William James and Wilhelm Wundt, when the empirical study of the mind began. So that's 140 years. The nature of the correlations between brain and mind remain as unknown, as mysterious, as unfathomed now as they did 140 years ago. The nature of consciousness, they can't even define it. They can't measure it. They don't know what causes it. What they have is a whole bunch of beliefs. Whereas the Buddhists have a whole bunch of methods with conclusions that can be tested. So it's really like the tables are turned here, whereas the science is on the Buddhism side and the mere beliefs on the science side, and people keep on pussyfooting around that. So what I found is a great openness from people like the Dalai Lama and any other Buddhists of learning, tell us about, you know, how do you study meditation? Tell us about the brain, tell us about the brain. What I have found, and pardon me if I feel a little bit cynical here, is far, far, far less openness on the part of scientists to take seriously the discoveries that have been made over 2,500 years of extremely rigorous research into the nature and potentials of the mind. And they tend to say, well, but let's get back to our EEG and our MRI and because we're the ones, actually, after all, we're European or we're Eurocentric. It's basically a type of ideological empiricism, not empiricism, imperialism, with which I have very little patience, because I'm very keen on people coming together as you and I are right now. After all, this is, of course, this is an interview. You're asking me questions, but I participate in dialogue all over the place. And I'm very happy to come and meet with people as collaborators, coming in with different strengths, learning from each other. I have much less interest in meeting with people where they feel they hold all the cards and they're going to inform me about their strengths without taking it seriously. I don't care about their being interested in my insights. But if people, scientists or anybody else, are coming to Buddhism for dialogue and they're not willing to listen with an open mind and question their own assumptions, then that, to my mind, is a very imbalanced type of dialogue. And I don't participate in that anymore because my life is too short. As I said, I'm blunt.
Thank you. I appreciate your candor. And now I'm curious about the alternative approach that you've taken, both in the Santa Barbara Institute of Consciousness Studies, but particularly in the Shamatha project of joining the subjective and objective, scientific observation and contemplative practice. How are you creating a kind of new science of the mind through those methods?
Well, on the one hand, I have, having practiced Shamatha, Vipassana, and then especially the Mahamudra and Dzogchen approach, with Mahamudra and Dzogchen now for, 25 years, and the Shamatha Vipassana for more like 40 years, there's arisen a very, very strong confidence, very, very strong confidence. This is extremely, rigorous, replicable, gives rise to insights, discoveries that are every bit as replicable, as robust, and as authentic as the scientific studies and measurements of the speed of light or the inverse square law of gravity. I mean, they're the same and they're acquired in a similar way. But what I've not seen happen thus far is research that is truly has kind of a parity to it, that has a mutual respect to it, where both sides are coming together, recognizing, look, the scientific tradition, that's 400 years of terrific success. But it's primarily hedonic. Hedonic, not in some crude way, but simply the benefits of science really are more for our material well-being, for our health, for transportation and communication, for food and so forth. And we all know that's very, very important. But there's this other Greek term, hedonia, which is what science is really good at. And there's also eudaimonia, genuine well-being. Science doesn't really help us out with that much. It's a very new item, and we're kind of dancing around with it. Whereas Buddhism has been dealing with eudaimonia for 2,500 years. I mean, it's called dambedewa, satsuka, or sublime or authentic well-being. That's a Buddhist term, very, very close to the Greek notion of eudaimonia. So the vision here is, let's move ahead. Let's not get stuck in this holding pattern, to my mind, a holding pattern of scientists coming in and studying the brains and behavior of meditators. That's fine. But imagine a number of cognitive scientists really wanting to understand mathematics and lining up a whole bunch of mathematicians and saying, we want to understand mathematics. Please come into our lab and we'll study your brains while you're doing mathematics. You should be chuckling at this point. That's a knucklehead. Are you kidding me? You're going to find out that, so okay, the amygdala, the hippocampus with the frontal cortex is involved while you're doing math. You really think you're going to understand math this way? Get real. And of course they don't. Then why do they think they're really going to understand meditation? By fathoming neural correlates. I mean, you're missing the mark drastically. So what I'm envisioning, and we're working very, very strong now, very heartfelt, well, globally, to create a network of what I call contemplative observatories. And in fact, ecumenical, not just Buddhist, because otherwise it can very easily look like, oh, you're trying to prove Buddhism, you're trying to get science to validate Buddhism. I'm sorry, but Buddhism doesn't need to be validated by science. It's doing very well without it. Thank you. And the scientists don't need to be validated by Buddhism either. We're both fine. We're cool. But what hasn't happened yet, I think even to this day, is full-scale collaboration, that we create basically a contemplative laboratory, or what I call a contemplative observatory. People are very well prepared to really spend some sustained time, months or years, in full-time contemplative research. Not just doing a three-year retreat or being mindful or doing sadhanas and so forth. All of that is good. I have no criticism. But there is such a thing as contemplative inquiry designed to make discoveries that can have a radical and very liberating effect on the person participating in the research. And this is centrally for all Buddhist schools, shamatha and vipassana. But don't skip shamatha. And it skipped all over the place. You know, just soft pedal that. Let's get to Mahamudra. Soft pedal that. Let's get to, you know, some esoteric practice in Vajrayana. Never mind that. Let's just go to vipassana. You know, it's all over the place. Well, it's like trying to do astronomy without a telescope. The shamatha is indispensable. And that's, it's so obviously there and so obviously overlooked. And so a network, right now I'm especially focusing on Tuscany, we found a beautiful property there, but a network, and each of these grassroots, I'm not an empire builder. I'm not interested in creating a whole set of Alan Wallace centers around the world. I have no interest in doing that at all. But I do have an interest in catalyzing and collaborating with working with like-minded people. And this can include, and hopefully it will include, not only Buddhists from all different schools, but also there are Christian contemplatives, and of course Hindu contemplatives, and Taoist contemplatives. I'd love to have some Sufi contemplatives, and some very devout Jews coming in with the strength of the Kabbalah tradition. It's incredibly profound. And so we have multiple contemplative traditions coming in, radically empirical and rational, and saying, what have you discovered? How do you discover it? Let's go in here in this laboratory, do our own research. That's unprecedented. That's without parallel. But in addition, from the opening day, invite open-minded scientists. This would be neuroscientists, cognitive psychologists, affective psychologists. We could bring in some philosophers too. They're often very, very smart. And say, let's do this collaboratively. Because we have something here that is a natural phenomenon, and it's called consciousness. More broadly speaking, the mind. And frankly, we in the modern world have not fathomed it. Scientists can't define it. They can't measure it. They don't know what causes it. They don't know how it interacts with the brain. We have this ridiculous term, placebo effect, and even ridiculous references like the power of the placebo. I mean, it should have people rolling in the aisles with laughter, because a placebo, for heaven's sakes, is a sugar tablet. It has no power. So what is this placebo effect? Well, it's a misnomer for the power of your own mind, expectation, belief, desire, trust, to actually bring about very mysterious shifts in the brain and the body driven only by your belief. That's a scientific fact. And I've corresponded with some world experts in this, both an anthropologist as well as a neuroscientist. I said, how do you explain that? And of course, almost all of them materialists. And one of them responded, I've stopped asking the question. Because there is no answer from the materialist paradigm. There's no answer at all. This is like voodoo. It shouldn't happen. It does. It's embarrassing. So either you start questioning your underlying assumptions or you stop asking the question. And by and large, the scientific community decided not to ask the question. You know, well, that's bad science. There shouldn't be any taboos in science. And I wrote a whole book called The Taboo of Subjectivity, showing that this is one where they skirt around it. They try to do away with it. They try to simply equate it with the brain function. It's pseudoscience from start to finish. Because if the scientists can't define consciousness and they can't measure it, there is no science of consciousness. Really, any more than there's a science of elves or leprechauns. If you can't measure them, let's not talk about a science of leprechauns. But consciousness is something that we do know exists. Leprechauns, more dicey. But consciousness, despite some of the most outrageously ridiculous claims from the neuroscientific community, there's an article by, I keep it anonymous because I don't like to ridicule people, but there was a very reputable neuroscientist that said consciousness doesn't exist. And he said it in public. Published in the New York Times. I thought, if you can read my article, then you've disproved me. I think that's hilarious. And yet they call themselves scientists. So to get to the point, something constructive. A network of contemplative observatories where open-minded scientists are welcome, open-minded contemplatives from the Buddhist and other traditions, and saying, look, nobody has all the answers here. Buddhism has basically nothing to say about the brain, and the brain is important. Science, when really honest, have nothing to say about consciousness because they can't even define it. Or they have 50 definitions. That's as good as nothing, because none of them are agreed upon, and they can't measure it. So the materialists all believe, they all believe, like, you know, devout religious devotees, at death, it's lights out, it's curtains, nothing happens, you're terminated. Well, that would be very, very compelling if they actually knew what caused consciousness in the first place. Whoops, they don't. So much of what goes under the rubric of secular Buddhism is basically a hostile takeover of materialists exercising a cognitive imperialism and taking over Buddhism and throwing everything out that doesn't accord with their beliefs. Now, the Dalai Lama said many times, if you show me some empirical fact demonstrated by good, rigorous research, we're ready to throw out anything in Buddhism that's refuted by empirical fact. Great, I'm on board with that. But when you take empirical discoveries from Buddhism and you throw them out because they don't conform with your metaphysical beliefs that the mind is nothing more than brain function, I think, well, this is back-assward science. This is pseudoscience. This is a joke. And I'm not going to jump onto that bandwagon. You know, that's just going down. Man, that's just ridiculous. I'm too much of a scientist to believe that.
Great. Well, let's think more about the constructive approaches that you've actually engaged. I remember about the Shamatha project, part of which happened at Shambhala Mountain Center. Mm-hmm. People locked behind closed doors for months at a time. And can you tell us a little bit about your methods, but also your findings? What was it all about?
Well, for the findings themselves, I mean, there were findings. I would say this, as I was the person who initiated that, I contacted my old friend Clifford Sarin, who's a very good neuroscientist. He was the principal investigator, and they did a marvelous job. The scientists were so conscientious. They were courteous. They were respectful to all of us. I was the teacher for that. It was just a splendid scientific study, and it was the scientists studying the brain states, the behavior, and they were interviewing the meditators. And all the papers published were by scientists, and by and large, you don't have a clue who the meditators were. So definite lack of parity there, right? But it was a good study. And to understand what exactly came out of that, I would simply refer, you should have another conversation with Clifford Sarin, because he was the outstanding principal investigator for this. And they published a lot of papers. They had something like 22 terabytes of data coming out of this massive study, the largest study of meditation ever done, even, I think, to the present day. And they keep on coming out with more papers. And this is now, what, 8 years since the data was collected at Shambhala Mountain Center in 2007. So I think that was a great big stride in the right direction. People being rigorously trained, and the methods that I taught, that I selected, and they turned out to be good selections, were basic mindfulness of breathing as a shamatha method. It was very helpful for calming the mind. And then observing the mind itself. This is a central Mahamudra and Dzogchen practice of simply observing thoughts, images, and so forth arising. And that can be a shamatha practice, a very, very rigorous one. And then the third one that I taught is, again, primarily from the Mahamudra and Dzogchen traditions, of simply resting in the awareness of awareness. Three really marvelously sublime practices. And in addition, because I didn't want the practice to become too arid, is we had a lot of emphasis on the four immeasurables, so four divine abidings of loving kindness, compassion, empathetic joy, and equanimity. And so it turned out to be, head and heart, mind and heart. It turned out to be a very, very good balance. We had nobody from that retreat that had any really serious psychological breakdown or anything like that. To the astonishment of the scientists, nobody left, and they weren't locked in. There were no cages where, the scientists would lock the door and now meditate. And so it really was, I think, a great success, and they're still analyzing the data. So a good milestone, and I'm very content to have spent that time, and I continue to collaborate with the scientists, reviewing the papers they write and adding my comments here and there. But I think the next step, and now being utterly constructive, I feel like, in this kind of conversation, I feel first sweep out the room of all the junk, and then, okay, what do you do in the clean room? And throwing out the junk of unquestioned metaphysical assumption materialism is sweeping that out because it's not science, it's pseudoscience. Now we're finished with that. So where's the next step ahead? Well, if what we're doing now is doing everything we can to create one and then more contemplative observatories. And these are places where people will receive rigorous training by one and more very, very highly trained and accomplished meditation teachers in practices that are transparent, that is primarily focusing on shamatha vipassana. And they'll be training as if you're getting an undergraduate degree or a graduate degree in neuroscience or cognitive psychology. I'm anticipating people could spend 4, 6, 8 years or longer in full-time research, meditating as I have many, many times for 12 hours a day. I've spent something like, 5 years in retreat, maybe 40,000 hours altogether. So I think I've taken it seriously. But then what would be unprecedented is not simply interviewing the meditators about their experiences. And then the scientists writing everything up. Again, all the professional expertise on the scientific side, whereas the meditators are the subjects. And they were the subjects. Not one meditator wrote any paper or was any asked to write a paper. Well, there's a lack of parity there. And I'm for parity. I'm for mutual collaboration. So imagine then a center where we have professionally trained mind scientists and professionally trained contemplatives who spent 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 years, and they're making their own discoveries. Now, shamatha is a really good place to start because it's so well mapped out. There are 9 stages leading to the final culmination of actually achieving shamatha. And so one of the research projects I'd love to see happen, and it really could, is create the environment, like creating a lab. It is a contemplative lab. Bring in scientists from the very beginning, maybe access to an MRI in a nearby city, because they're expensive. EEG is cheap and it's lightweight. You can bring it right to the meditation site. And then have questionnaires, have other kind of tests like we did in the Shamatha project 8 years ago. And have these meditators then starting from ground zero. They're relatively new, but they're well prepared for spending 6, 8, 10, 12 hours a day in meditation. And then have the meditators be recording what's happening. What are the challenges? What are the breakthroughs? How is your mind changing? What are the benefits? What are the limitations? Are you having problems? They're giving a very detailed scientific account, rigorous, accurate, precise, of their first-person experiences. In the meantime, we could have cognitive psychologists doing their measurements of behavior with computer screens and various stimuli and so forth. And in the meantime, at least EEG, but there can be other measures as well. And maybe every 6 months or so, take them down to the nearest big hospital with the MRI and check, hey, how is your brain changing structurally and also functionally? How is the brain changing? You've just spent, 1,000 hours meditating. What's happening in the brain? So we're bringing now what I would call a three-dimensional view to what happens in very deep, sustained, rigorous meditation. First training attention skills, and then using them to really probe into the nature of the mind and multiple dimensions of the mind. And that we'll be coming in, we'll have then professional scientific accounts from psychologists who are looking at behavior and doing questionnaires, neuroscientists, we're looking at the correlated brain activity, and the highly trained, articulate, theoretically trained contemplatives. And now we have papers being published in 3 parts.
Sounds like you
also Well, it's part anthropology, but this is it, these barriers are artificial. That is, when you're meditating, it's not just brain activity, for heaven's sakes. It's not just stuff happening with your telomeres or telomerase. Your mind is changing, and the person who has the privileged access to what's happening in meditation while you're spending 10 hours a day meditating, who knows what's happening better than anybody else, is the meditator. So Francisco Varela, who I still dearly miss because he was such a light of open-mindedness and respect across cultures, I've really not found anyone to replace him. And that's not disparaging anybody else. It's simply, there is no Francisco Varela number 2. Not to my knowledge. I've never seen such a person. If I meet him, I want to make friends with that person. But in any case, Francisco Varela, I think, was one that commented, look, there's the first person perspective, and that's the meditator reporting on his or her own experience. There's second person perspective, and that's of the highly trained meditation teacher who's in regular conversation, dialogue, providing guidance for the meditators, and has another perspective that in some respects may be sharper and more insightful than even the meditator him or herself. Because they have so much, they may have 10 or 20 times more experience in meditation. So the meditation instructor's perspective really needs to be taken into account because they're professionals. And then the third person is, of course, the psychologist and the neuroscientist. They also have something that the meditation perspective, the meditation instructor doesn't have, and the meditators don't have. And so three-dimensional, bringing all of these into one, that's how it should have been done in the first place. And this is now transcending all ethnocentric limitations and coming into a multifaceted phenomenon that no one discipline can say, we've got it covered. Some Buddhists might like to think, oh no, we don't need neuroscience, we've got it covered. But they still don't know much about the brain. The neuroscientists and psychologists are very happy to say, hey, we got this covered. Meditators, just bring your brains, we'll check out your brains. That's hubris. And so nobody is covering all the bases. Therefore, the most scientific way to approach the scientific study of the mind would be to come in 3 doors simultaneously and have papers published by people in all 3 camps. Now, that would be holistic, non-reductionistic, and not dogmatically driven, which neuroscience often is because it's driven by the dogmatism of materialism. And Buddhism, of course, can be driven by its own metaphysical beliefs. And what we need now is radical empiricism. And I say that as a great admirer of William James.
Well, I'm struck by how you were drawn to meditation practice and Buddhism, generally speaking, from a desire for meaning, and how, in a way, practice is a meaning-making activity. And often in the mindfulness movement, you see bare attention being separated out from other kinds of domains like ethics, cosmology, belief systems altogether. And so I'm just curious, as you're talking about an integrative approach, then to what extent does the views that are held by the meditators, the actual instructions that are beyond just the scientific operations of the mind, where do you see those fit in? And when you talk about a kind of attention revolution, what is the nature of that revolution?
Boy, you like to throw big juicy ones to me, don't you? Well, sure, I'll start, you know, in very traditional Buddhist response, but I think enormously meaningful. And it's also transparent. There's no blind belief here at all. And that is, if you're interested in really developing your attention skills, you'll also want to be looking for motivation, what I call cognitive balance, cognitive intelligence. If you really want to do this seriously, not just 20 minutes a day, you're going to want to have a motivation that has authentic sound, that really has some staying power and not simply a whim, you know, like trying out ping pong. And so your cognitive balance, developing authentic motivations that are in accord with reality, that really are meaningful, that'll be important. And then developing your attention balance. If you want to go into Vipassana and really gain some understanding and just develop attention skills, then Vipassana, you want cognitive balance. And then overall, emotional balance. You know, if we're just flying off the handle, you know, just bipolar, or just really excitable or emotionally imbalanced, that's not going to turn out well. It doesn't turn out well anywhere. But if you're really trying to meditate 8 hours a day and you have a crummy motivation, just silly motivation, your cognitive balance, because you're just bogged down in all of your unquestioned beliefs, and you're emotionally, you're just kind of like, you know, a can of worms. That's not going to work out well. So the larger agenda here, when we think of the three higher trainings in Buddhism, ethics, samadhi, and wisdom, samadhi is not just developing single-pointed attention, it's developing exceptional mental balance, exceptional mental health. If we don't understand that, we've missed it. And samadhi is just the cipher for that. But here's a point that I think is transparently true, but maybe it could be studied more scientifically. And that is, if I'm engaging in a way of life where I'm manipulative, I'm deceitful, I exploit people, and so forth, really harming people, you know, by lying, stealing, manipulation, abuse, contempt, and so forth and so on. And then I think after I've then mutilated somebody with my words or showed condescension, contempt, and so forth, and then I get back on my meditation cushion, I'm developing loving kindness, that's not going to work out. So ethics for contemplative inquiry, ethics is indispensable. For science, it's actually not. There are scientists throughout history have been just happy to work for the biggest pay, for weapons of mass destruction, for Nazis, for communists, for fascists, and so forth and so on. And they can still do good science, sadly, but they can. And that's why we have such a mess militarily, because the scientists were acting like, frankly, prostitutes, just willing to sell their wares to the highest bidder. Well, if you're a meditator, that doesn't work. You have to have ethics. It's not optional. Then we have the training of the mind, the balancing of the mind, and then we have wisdom. So there's one framework, Shila, Samadhi, Prajna, ethics, samadhi, and wisdom. It's sensible. That's what I'd say about that. But there's another triad that also easily gets overlooked and is enormously important, and I think it's universally relevant. And that is, whatever type of activity we engage in, our beliefs, our assumptions, our worldview, how we actually view reality, has an enormous bearing. It has an impact on the activity itself, right? But then whatever activity, whether it's scientific research or whether it's meditation, but let's focus on meditation. Meditation for pretty much all of us, very few people are meditating formally on the cushion 24 hours a day, which means our meditation, even if it's 8 hours a day, that means 16 hours a day, we're not formally meditating. Meditation is embedded in a way of life. And the really effective meditator who makes great breakthroughs, true transformation, are really proceeding along a path to freedom and spiritual awakening. These are ones for whom their worldview is in complete harmony and supportive of the meditative practice. The meditative practice deepens their view, but the meditative practice is also embedded in a way of life that is utterly conducive to and supportive of their meditation and their view, and the meditation deepens and purifies and brings greater benevolence and goodness and clarity and wisdom to their way of life. So I'll give you two triads to wrap this up. And that is, there is a materialistic worldview that states, in effect, that everything in the universe consists of space, time, matter, energy, and their emergent properties. That's quite a big statement of hubris. I mean, how on earth do you know that is not a scientific statement? Because nobody's ever tested that. It's just a belief. It's kind of like, you know, just a belief. It's kind of a silly one too. But that's a worldview. A lot of people have jumped onto that bandwagon. So if you're holding a materialistic worldview, I'll tell you about a set of values that really is completely in accordance with that. And it's hedonic. And that if everything that exists is material, then I know where to find happiness. It's by manipulating material. I mean, it's vitamins and it's sex and it's money and it's prestige and power and it's living here and doing this and this and that. It's all about doing and shifting material phenomena so that I can get what I want, which is happiness. But it's directly coinciding with hedonic values, which basically says my happiness lies out there. And I'm going to find the person, the place, the job, the entertainment, the cell phone, the computer thing, do it, you know, do me a lot of my brain so I can shortcut meditation and do it really quickly and not have to fuddy-duddy around like those Zen masters who practice 40 years. Oh, I've got a new contraction. You can do that in 5 minutes. Cool. You know, so that's hedonic. And then you've got a materialistic worldview, hedonic values, and then you're looking at way of life. I can tell you it's a consumer-driven way of life. And it's what the world is following. And the idea is the more I can consume, and the faster, the better. So let's hope that all the nations of the world have ever-increasing GDPs. And so we can suck this earth dry as quickly as possible. And then we can go to the spare earth, you know, after we've completely totaled this one. And we can all do a mass migration to the next one next door, where we can do it all over again. The only problem with that model is there's no next door. So this is basically global suicide. The notion that all 7 billion of us can consume more and more and more, acquire more and more, and that's a sign of success, and that's a good thing. We should all start freaking out if China has a GDP drop below 7%, because, oh, heavens to Betsy, what's going to happen to the global economy if China doesn't continue to grow? This is blatant insanity, but it's insanity promoted by presidents and prime ministers and economists all over the world, and you kind of just think, what on earth is happening in their minds to think this is going to turn out well? It is crazy. Right? But there's a triad, a materialistic worldview, hedonic values, and a consumer-driven way of life. They fit together very well. If this is your triad and you introduce meditation, like mindfulness, it's going to be embedded in that worldview, driven by your hedonic values, and basically be dropped into a consumer-driven way of life where this is just one more technique, you know, to find your hedonic pleasure. It makes me feel good. It reduces stress, which is very nice. But it means you've lost the entire point of all of Buddha Dhamma and all of spirituality altogether. So a worldview that is not Cartesian dualism, but in the words of William James, my intellectual hero, pluralistic, it has a good big dose of humility in it, which materialism does not. And that is, look, this is a vast universe. And to think that everything that happens in the universe somehow fits into our conceptual categories of Eurocentric civilization in the 21st century is one of the most ridiculous statements made in the history of the cosmos. Like, who on earth do you think you are? That you've got the whole of reality and there's nothing outside of your four gospels, matter, energy, space, and time. And all of reality has to fit into that. I'm saying, oh, come on, get real. This is just religious fundamentalism all over again. And it's calling itself science. What a joke. And so, you know, get real. This is a much bigger universe than you ever imagined. Why don't we just have this open-ended, pluralistic, that is not just mind and matter, but there's also information, which is not physical and is not simply a mental state. There's also justice and there's beauty and there's mathematical laws. There are many, many things that we already know about that are neither matter nor minds. So let's not go back to Descartes. But let's not get stuck in this quagmire of thinking everything has to be materialist, which I find just a joke. I get tired of refuting it because it's like trying to refute that the moon is made out of whipped cream. I mean, why does anybody believe that? And I want to stop the debate. This is just too boring. So first of all, a pluralistic worldview. In terms of values, the fate of our civilization, ready for a big bombastic statement? Here's one. The fate of human civilization and the planet hinges on whether we can re-envision what the good life is. That it's got to be an alternative to acquire more, consume more, poop out more, and defile and spoil the planet until there's nothing left. And that's the end of human civilization. That's the track we're on right now. We need to rediscover by under whatever name, there's another way to flourish in this world that is not about consumption and acquisition. It's about transforming your way of life, cultivating your mind, and finding a sense of well-being that is not stimulus dependent. And that's what the Greeks knew about. All the great wisdom traditions of the world have known about this, and we've ignored it. We have to wake up and recognize the wisdom of our own cultures all over the planet, because it's there. You just have to know where to look. And then likewise, and then finally, in terms of a consumer-driven way of life, hey, there's a Buddhist principle, but it's all over the place. Be satisfied with that which is sufficient. When you can pay your bills, when you take care, your children are taken care of, they have education, health, food, and clothing, then be content. And don't just keep on looking for more of the same. Don't be a lemming. Wake up that it's good to have enough. It would be good for everybody to have enough. Unlike the present situation where the 85 most wealthy people on the planet, this is a true statement, the 85 wealthiest people on the planet own as much as the poor 3.5 billion people on the planet. 85 own what the poor 3.5 billion own. In other words, they've all became, those 85 people all became Buddhist monk, gave away everything. They could double the assets of half the people on the planet. Now there's something seriously, seriously wrong about that. And it's everywhere, especially in Eurocentric, United States Eurocentric, but it is absolutely catastrophic. And that we cannot support human civilization with that. So that's where I think this is not just a debate. This is like, hey, our very survival as the species here, we have to wake up and recognize that this triad of materialism, hedonism, and consumerism, it's poison. So Marx said that religion is the opium of the people, and I will say materialism is the datura of intellectuals. It's complete delusion, and they don't even know they're deluded. So we have to start waking up quickly. And so spiritual awakening for humanity, we better get down to the brass tacks and not just do more neuroscientific studies of brain states when people are meditating. That's very sweet, but it's missing the point, frankly.
Thank you. Wow, that was a wonderful answer. And I've asked you many questions, and I wonder if you have a question that drives your own work, that is a living question or a heart question that keeps you digging deeper in your studies, in your practice.
I have many questions and I'm actively pursuing them. But one of them is, I do think a lot about children. To say that they are future is a cliche, but it's a cliche because it is so profoundly true. And I feel now I'm 65, so I'm grandfather age. I am a grandfather. I have a 10-year-old grandson. And I look at the world that my grandson is being raised in the Los Angeles area, kind of a big, great big city of materialism, hedonism, and consumerism. I've lived there. I know what I'm talking about. It's not all bad, but it's really dominant there. And I'm looking at my grandchild's generation and I'm thinking what is obvious. And that is, he got a raw deal. He got a raw deal. But my generation, my parents' generation, and the next generation down have delivered to the children of today. This is a really difficult world we've given them. We're sucking the earth dry. We polluted it, contaminated it, vast inequities of wealth, economic challenges all over the place. We've given them a really tough world to grow up in. And that's spilled milk. I mean, that's just the way it is. But if we recognize that is true, it's a lot more difficult to grow up as a healthy, well-balanced, happy child now than I think it was when I grew up in the 50s. I think that's true. Just in so many ways, I won't elaborate, but I think it's really resoundingly true. So let's assume that's true. Let's assume that I'm not just a grumpy old geezer harkening back to the good old days. They weren't that great, actually, in the 1950s, but you know, they're not like now. But if this is true, that we've presented our children with unprecedented challenges, which are enormous, and they're urgent, and in some ways are catastrophic, then I think we have a profound moral responsibility to do everything we possibly can for our children, to enlighten them, to awaken them, and to these simple facts that there are people who are extremely well, happy and have meaningful and fulfilling lives who are not wealthy. And there are countless number of extremely wealthy people who are getting by from day to day on antidepressants and medication to get them to sleep and get medication for this and medication for that. And, you know, children should know about this. There's a good book called The High Price of Materialism by Timothy Kasser. That should be taught everywhere because it's not religious. It's just saying, look, if you get wealthier and wealthier, it doesn't make you happier and happier. But then you have to say something else. We want to be happier. How can we be happier? We should be teaching. How can we do that? That should be part of our general education system. Teaching children attention skills from the age of 5. Susan Kaiser Greenland, a very good friend of mine, she's really learned how to teach mindfulness, attention skills, and compassion to very young children in ways they enjoy. So we should be just brainstorming about this. We should be throwing money at it, well-directed money, to enriching our education system. The children early on have a sense, a broader vision of what does it mean to flourish, to be happy? How do you find inner well-being? A broader vision and helping them cope with the challenges we presented to them for their disadvantage and to our advantage for our quick profit. So that's something I feel great, great passion about. And it's not sectarian. It's not against any group. No, it's not like us and them. But I think we need to be brainstorming a lot more than we are now, because the status quo isn't working. And we need to recognize that. That's why I do critique materialism. If it was just some silly idea, and it is a silly idea, then we say, well, you know, if you believe the earth was created 7,000 years ago, that's a silly idea. But really, how many people is that hurting? If you really believe, you know, the earth was, I mean, does that really hurt anybody? It's a crazy idea, of course, but does it hurt anybody? And my answer is, I don't think so, you know? But this one, this is hurting people. This is, we've wiped out half the life, the wildlife on the planet in the last 40 years. We're emptying the oceans of fish. They'll be empty by 2050. And, you know, we have to start waking up really quickly and seeing the status quo doesn't work. And it's not just killing us. It's killing our brothers and sisters, other species on the planet. And we have no right. We have no right. We have to wake up now. This is our moral responsibility.
Thank you so much, Alan, for this visionary journey from mind science to how meditation could help us address our ecological crisis. It was a wonderful, informative, and poignant discussion about envisioning how we can be awake in the world. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome. Thank you for the opportunity. I hope there's some benefit. That's why we're both here.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
To learn more about these presenters, please visit the websites listed below.
Nestled in a beautiful mountain valley in the Colorado Rockies, Shambhala Mountain Center has been a destination for individual and societal awakenment for over 40 years. Every season, extraordinary people gather here to take part in a rich variety of retreats. Some come for a day, some for a weekend, a week, or a month, and some stay for decades. Everyone contributes a little something, or perhaps a big something, to this ongoing endeavor of manifesting good human culture. Good human experience. It is said that the potency of the teachings, practice, and blessings that have occurred here over the years from some of the most powerful teachers of our modern era have processed the energies of the land in such a way that people's hearts and minds become quite available here. Shambhala Mountain Center is also home to the Great Stupa of Dharmakaya, a monument to human kindness and one of the largest and most significant examples of sacred architecture in North America. Thus, a visit to this mountain valley retreat is not only an occasion to slow down and rejuvenate, it is an opportunity for genuine transformation. Awakened heart, inherent goodness, peace, sanity. Rediscover it here. Radiate it everywhere.